Hello, everyone. We're hitting about 7 p.m., so we're going to try and get started. So welcome to tonight's event, which is Culturally Inclusive ADLs, hosted by the University of Pittsburgh COTAD chapter. Just a quick reminder that tonight's event will be recorded. Some portions will be recorded, so please keep that in mind. But first and foremost, we want to thank all of you for joining us here tonight. The interest we had in this event was honestly overwhelming, and we thank you for that. I think it just is such a testament to the amount of interest and the need to discuss certain topics and kind of the lack of knowledge we all have and that we're seeking in our own education. So thank you guys for joining us in that way. Our group is made up of occupational therapy students. So we're really trying to, you know, achieve that with you guys. So thank you for joining us in that journey. For those of you that are new here, we again are the University of Pittsburgh COTAD chapter. We are entirely made of students, COTAD standing for the Coalition of Occupational Therapy Advocates for Diversity. And we're just a group of students who are extremely passionate and caring about expanding our knowledge base and really trying to educate us on things that we yet don't know. And our chapter's personal mission is to promote diversity, equity, and inclusion within the Pitt OT community and empower students to be more comprehensive and effective clinicians. We hope tonight's event really exceeds that mission because we have so many people in attendance outside of our own smaller Pitt community, people from different parts of the country, students, practitioners, OTs, and non-OTs alike. So that's really great. And I think it shows that these types of conversations and knowledge really help to unify us. So with all that in mind, our faculty advisor, Jennifer White, would like to have a few words before we transition on.
You would think that I'd be well equipped to take myself off of mute by now after spending a year on Zoom. However, apparently I've proven that myself wrong. So I would like to extend welcome to everybody, a big Pitt welcome. As the faculty advisor to Pitt's COTAD chapter, I really would like to thank all of you for joining us this evening. I'm really excited to see such a great turnout for the event that our Pitt students have organized. I think the topic of culturally inclusive ADLs is important for our community to discuss and to be more informed about. I also think that it's equally as important that you are all forming a part of a bigger community that continues to educate each other now, but then also beyond today's event. So that's, I think, very exciting to me. So I'd like to extend a thank you to our panelists this evening, and of course to the Pitt students who have organized the event tonight. And I'm going to share something that is part of our Pitt OT community with everybody. We have a saying in Pitt OT, and it's, you make us Pitt proud. And I would like to extend that sentiment to all of you who have joined us this evening. So Pitt OT students and panelists, please take it away.
All right, here's the agenda for tonight. First, we have some light housekeeping tips we want to inform you about, and we want to tell you about our upcoming chapter events. Then we'll transition into the speaker portion of the event where each of the speakers will share their expertise. Throughout the speaker portion, we will encourage you to type your questions into the Q&A chat box. And as each speaker presents, you may have questions, but we ask that you save your questions until the Q&A session at the end. If you see a question that you want answered, you do have the ability to upvote another attendee's question. And if you have a question for a specific speaker, please include their name in your question. So our next events, next month, March 25th, we have an interprofessional LGBTQIA+ healthcare panel. And for that one, we are actually joining forces with four other COTAD chapters, and we'll be hearing from healthcare professionals who are part of the LGBTQIA+ community, and they'll be sharing their expertise. Then in April, we'll have an autism and neurodiversity panel filled with community members who are who are part of the autistic community and actually autistic. So we hope that you'll be on the lookout for those and join us for those as well. And without further ado, we'll meet our first speaker of the night.
Okay. Hey, so hello everyone. So our first speaker tonight is Mariah. Mariah is currently a first year PhD student at Jefferson University studying biomedical sciences with a specialty in cell biology and regenerative medicine. She is rotating in a cancer biology laboratory studying prostate and bladder cancer. She has been a natural hair influencer since 2016. Growing up, she struggled to find tutorials from people with hair like hers. In high school, she stumbled across some natural hair influencers who taught her hairstyles for her hair texture. The more she experimented, the more she found others asking about how she took care of her hair. She decided to dedicate her time documenting her natural hair journey and her experience with different natural products and styles on Instagram and YouTube page, Curly by Nature. Ever since, she made it her mission to help others on her journey. So thank you so much, Mariah, for coming to our event.
You're welcome. Thank you guys for having me. I'm just going to share my screen really quick. Can you guys see the PowerPoint? Okay. So this presentation is going to be about culturally inclusive activities of daily living for a girl with natural hair, or me. It's not going forward. Sorry. Okay. So a little bit about me. Right here is all of my family, basically. I'm a sister. I'm a cousin. I'm an aunt. I'm a daughter. I'm a girlfriend. So all of these people in these pictures have entrusted me in some way, shape, or form with their hair activities of daily living. So they have let me do their hair, recommend products, all that type of stuff. So that's why I wanted to put them in there, and they really are my backbone. So I also wanted to put them in there for that. So a little bit more about me, like was said, I am a scientist by day, I guess, as well as doing the natural hair stuff. I love being in the lab and I love helping people in this way through research. So some of the, well, I was asked to speak a little bit about some of the things that were said to me that kind of sparked this natural hair journey and like sparked the importance of the activities of daily living that connected with my natural hair. So my freshman year of high school, somebody literally told me that my hair looked like a bad weave. This really, I guess, affected me in the sense that my hair was something that was important to me. It was something I was experimenting with. It was something that I wasn't really beforehand able to experiment with because like my mom would just put braids in it because that's easy. So on this experimental journey, that was something that really affected me and I think really sparked a change in me and like wanting to do my hair and wanting to learn more about my hair and not just like put doing whatever to it. So some other, I guess, negative comments that I've gotten about my hair in a sense is that all of your hair? I feel like that's a disrespectful question and something that you shouldn't really ask people. And then the other popular phrase that can come off as being disrespectful is you must be mixed because I have good hair. So that being said, that sparked my YouTube and Instagram journey because I wanted people with hair like mine to know how to take care of it. So some of the more positive things that people said to me is how do you get your hair like that? And what products do you use? So these questions sparked me to create a platform to share with people, oh, this is what I do. This is what I use. This is how I figured out my hair. So maybe you can figure out your hair. So next, I just want to go into some of my cultural activities of daily living. These are just a few things that I do that I feel as though are different from everybody else, because obviously in the morning, everybody wakes up, showers, brushes their teeth. But these are my morning activities that I think are a little different. So every morning I read the Bible and I give honor to God and I pray. And after that, I get out of my bed and I take my bonnet off and I look at my hair and I say, okay, what do I want to do with it today? Do I want to leave it in the condition that it's in? Do I need to take it out? Do I need to brush it, comb it? What do I need to do? And then after that, I decide if I'm going to lay my edges or not. These are edges, just to let y'all know, like baby hairs. So that's what I do in the morning. And that takes me about 30 minutes to an hour to do. And then my nighttime routine is sort of similar. So I wrap my hair from the day. I wrap it back up to protect it at night because my hair can't get on cotton, because cotton will kind of like suck the moisture out of it and make it frizzy and not tolerable for the next day. So that's an important part of what I have to do. I also sometimes re-braid or retwist my hair depending on what type of style. So like, for example, in this picture on the left, I retwisted my hair the night before to get like this twist out look. And then I put a scarf or a bonnet on and call it a day. And I pray and just thank God for the day and everything that he took me through. So next, my wash day activities, I guess they're not daily living, but more so like weekly or bi-weekly living activities that I have to go through. So the first thing that I try to do is pre-poo, which is when you add oil to your hair to help soften it and help get it ready for wash day. The next thing I do is shampoo my hair. And after that, I condition or deep condition my hair. And after that, I style my hair. And these activities can take a few hours to all day, because on top of doing all of these things, I'm also recording content because I'm a content creator. So I'm recording content of me pre-pooing, shampooing, doing all these different activities to help show you guys what I do in a day for my hair. So before we get too much more into some of the tools and different things that I use for my activities of daily living, I wanted to run some quick hair terminology by you guys that became a part of my activities of daily living and became important to me. So first is hair type, and second is hair porosity. So hair type, that's basically just saying, what does my hair look like? So my hair is, well, my natural curl is 3B or 3C. So this is what my hair looks like in its natural state. Some people could have 1, which is like super straight. And then 4C is the most coily, tight, super tight curls that people tend to have. And next is hair porosity. So hair porosity is important in activities of daily living because it's going to help you pick the right products for you. So I have low porosity hair, which means that it's hard for products to get in, but it's just as hard for products to get out. So I know that there are certain products I can't use or can use because it's going to be easy or difficult for me to get out of my hair. The next type of porosity is called medium porosity. Some people call it normal porosity. It's basically the Goldilocks of hair. It means that your porosity is just right, like your hair can absorb products well and it gets rid of products well as well. The last type of hair porosity is called high porosity, which it's hard to get products in, but it's also hard to get product, or it's easy for products to come just back out of your hair. So all of these different hair types can accept different products and they'll react differently to different products. So here are some of the hair tools that I use. Some of them are unique, and I guess not everybody uses them, but these two items are actually available on Amazon. This is called an Octo Curl. It was something that somebody asked me to market for them, and I did, and I mean, it worked. And these are called waveformers. So both of these are ways to stretch your curls, which would be considered like a part of my styling routine and my activities of daily living. So some other props that I had to show you guys are some of my combs and brushes, because there's a lot of different types of combs and brushes. So we can start with the combs. So this is an Afro pick. So this, I just go in at my roots and it helps me to fluff my hair out. This is a detangling comb. So the teeth are wide and they have combs with wider teeth as well. And this is going to help me detangle my hair. But more often now than not, I'm using this comb, this brush actually, to detangle my hair because it kind of goes with my hair, if that makes sense. Like, it glides with my hair. So I really like this to detangle as well. And then for combs, this is called a rat tail comb. And this is another version of it. This helps me when I'm styling to part my hair and to really make sure that my parts are as even and as clean as possible because of this thin end. I really don't use this top part because my hair is too thick for it, but I do use these ends to part my hair. And then, oh, my edge brush. I put this in here because I use this like every day to do my edges. It looks kind of like a toothbrush, and it's like a tiny baby brush to help you really like slick down your baby hairs. So those are just some of the tools. Like, I have more, but those are just some of the more important ones that I use pretty much on a daily or weekly basis. So now I just want to speak to you guys a little bit about hair products and the importance of hair products in your activities of daily living. If you are constantly using a product, you want to make sure that it's doing the best that it can for you. So when I look for products, I look for either natural products or clean products. So natural products are products that have ingredients that are all found in nature. So an oil, for example, would have like coconut oil, jojoba oil. All those things can be extracted from something in nature. So I call those natural products. Clean products, on the other hand, aren't necessarily all found naturally. Like, you can't go out and get it from the garden or something. Like, it's something that's synthesized in a lab, but it has low toxicity levels, which you want, if you're exposing yourself to it daily or weekly even, or bi-weekly even, you want to make sure that it has like a low toxicity. You don't want to be introducing toxins into your body constantly. And the price range for the natural products are from $15 and up, which isn't ideal, but that's just the nature of it. Typically, the better products are more expensive. So these are just some key ingredients that at all costs, if you can't get natural or clean products, you just want to avoid these at all costs if you can. So sulfates specifically for curly hair girls are bad because they strip your curls. One of the shampoos that I used to use before I went natural, I didn't know had sulfates in it, and it was stripping my curls, and it makes your curls look frizzy after you wash your hair, and it just is not a good idea. Parabens are something that I'm not really sure what they're in products for. I didn't research that, but I did research why so many people say, oh, avoid parabens, because I've heard this for years. And apparently it can disrupt hormonal balance, which is something you also don't want. And the last thing that probably a lot of people have heard about, I'm assuming outside of the curly community, is fragrance and perfume. These ingredients can be carcinogenic or hormone disruptors, which basically means that they can mess things up in your body. And they have a toxicity level, I think, of like 7 or 8 out of 10. And you don't really want to introduce products with these ingredients to your body if you don't have to. And that's basically it. So if you guys had any questions or about natural hair or about like activities of daily living for somebody with natural hair, these are probably the best platforms to reach me on. And I think they'll be provided for you anyway. So yeah, I can stop sharing now.
All right, thank you for that, Mariah. We learned so much from you. I want to introduce our next speaker, who is Ifra. Ifra is currently a nursing student at The Ohio State University. She received her bachelor's in pharmaceutical science from OSU in 2019. As a Muslim woman, she has observed the hijab her entire life and is fortunate to have covered since she was little. She completed the Quran at 16 and has taught basic Arabic and Quran to youth at her local mosque for 2 years. Thank you so much, Ifra, for coming to join us tonight.
Of course, it's a pleasure to be here. I'm just gonna share my screen. Okay. cards. There's so many things. Okay, so it's an honor to be here. Thank you so much. Teresa, for inviting me. Today I'm going to be talking about cultural inclusivity and ADLs, a focus on Muslim women and the hijab. So what is hijab? In the modern day, it's been reduced down to garments, what people wear. That's not necessarily the case. So this is something that I kind of wanted to go in depth about. And so here in this ayah, it says, Ya ayyuhan nabiy qul li azwajika wa banatika wa nisa'il mu'minin yughnina 'alayhinna min jalabibihin. So this is one of the verses in the Quran that has that commandment of hijab, particularly the outer garments, but it also is to engage in modest conduct, speech, character, interactions. As Muslims, particularly Muslim women, we tend to refrain from unnecessary interactions with the opposite gender. So no like flirting or anything that could be, if it's not necessary, if it's not a school or work matter, usually that's something that Muslim women will tend to refrain from. And so it's not, as I mentioned, not necessarily things that people wear. It's more of a frame of mind. Profanity, if you're cursing, that would be something that would take away from your hijab, immodest speech, things of that nature. So as Muslim women, because we cover, it's very easy to like point and say, yes, like this is a Muslim woman. She's quote unquote religious, she's practicing. For men, they too have a hijab, a way of being and parameters that they need to follow. And so it's not as known, even Muslim men, sometimes it's not something that they necessarily abide by, but for them, so that we'll go through this table here. It's between the navel and knees. So they're required to cover from their belly button past their knees. This table, it says awra for males and females. Awra is what is required to be covered. I know I personally get a lot of questions about, you know, who's allowed to see your hair, when and where and what situations do you cover? And so I'm going to be going over that. This table's really good at summarizing that. So for men, as you see here, typically from navel to knees. So in all situations, in public and private, with relatives, when it comes to medical situations, navel to knees. For women, it's a little different. So in public, as you see right now, everything about my hands and my face are currently covered. At home, I don't wear the, well, I'm home right now, but this is different. Zoom life is a little different. But I typically, I don't wear the hijab. And I, you know, I have my doormats, I can wear jewelry, makeup, things like that. In front of opposite sex relatives, so people who are not my mahram, it's a category in the Quran where it's people you are legally like not allowed to marry. So like my brothers, my cousins, cousins actually is the exception, male cousins, but my grandfather, male relatives, you don't cover in front of them. Non-mahram, so men who are not, you're not related to, it's that same thing. Head to toe is all covered except the hands and the face. In emergency or extreme situations, or if it's medically necessary, then as, you know, as needed, it's there. I thought this is really funny, this meme that I saw. It says, this is not hijab, this is hijab for men. Women on, like, online, especially Muslim women, will get a lot of scrutiny because what is, what constitutes the hijab can be cultural, and what is hijab for Muslim men is just, it's loose and it covers head, you're only your hands and your face and your hands are exposed. So it can be different, like my culture, our way of wearing hijab, Pakistani culture, Bangladeshi culture, it's quite different. So women do get a lot of scrutiny. For men, they only have that, as we see back in this meme here, the man's belly button is exposed, his knees are exposed, he's literally not covering what is supposed to be covered. And so they had corrected that there. I thought that was funny. We're gonna be talking about the different types of hijab, but do note, like I said, the hijab is more of a mentality of modesty and not necessarily like a physical garment, even though, like I said, people kind of conflate the two. Even I use it in my daily life, like, oh, where's my hijab? Or can you grab that for me? Or my hijab is slipping, things like that. But there is that difference. The types here, Shayla, Hijab, Hijab Amira, Khimar, Shador, Niqab, Burqa. Some of these I don't personally use myself and or have never heard. I've only ever seen in diagrams like this when I see them online, like the the Hijab Amira or the Shador. I think that's mostly common in Iran, but I'm not from there, so I would not know. Not know in depth. For the niqab, actually, it's kind of funny. During COVID life, which we are currently in, you'll see a lot more niqabi women. I personally am kind of a COVID niqabi. It's much more easier to grab than my mask, to be honest. Much more breathable, I think. And there are some people who do believe that covering the face is wajib or is another thing that they should cover. So like I said, most people believe it's you can uncover your face and your hands, but for some who believe in slightly different rulings in Islam, they'll cover their face. But all of these are acceptable if you are covering, just like I said, loose clothing, and what needs to be covered versus uncovered, you're fine. You're in observance of the hijab. This is a tweet of mine. We're gonna be watching a hijab tutorial in a little bit. I thought I was funny. My two Twitter followers didn't think so. I said, hijab tutorials exist because folding khimar is akin to folding origami. Both require a deft hand in order to create the desired form. It's true. Some of these have multiple steps. This is the one, the video I'm about to show is just one example of many. There are hundreds of thousands on YouTube, so many different styles and different fabrics you could use, different things like that. But I will show you guys the video in just a second. It's right here. I believe that. Okay. I'm just gonna play and watch as she puts on her dress.
Description box to below, so just make sure to check that out. I'm going to use this beautiful chiffon hijab. It's like a dusty pink. It's so beautiful. And I thought it matched really well with this dress I'm wearing today. You will need
Yes.
I think you have to reshare your screen because we can still only see the PowerPoint. So if you pull up the YouTube and reshare, it should be good.
Okay. We'll do that. Sorry, you guys.
No, you're all good.
I didn't realize there were so many screens.
Perfect, we can see it now. Thank you.
That's right, thank you.
Below, so just make sure to check that out. I'm going to use this beautiful chiffon hijab. It's like dusty pink. It's so beautiful, and I thought it matched really well with this dress that I'm wearing today. You will need two small pins and one straight pin, and you're going to start with a small piece on one side and then a longer piece on the other side. And then frame it around your face to your liking. I don't ever make it too tight. Just kind of leave like a space so I can breathe and move my face and not feel like I'm choking. Okay, so now with the remainder of the small piece, you will tuck that inside of your blouse, your sweater, your dress, whatever you're wearing for that day. Take the long piece and wrap it around your head. Bring it over. So now you will take the straight pin and then pin it like right about here. And now you will take this piece again, and instead of going upwards, you're just going to go around your neck, okay? And bring the small little piece forward, take a small pin, and you're going to pin it right about here. You don't want it showing. And that's it. So usually it's like hanging off.
Okay, that was the video. As I said, sometimes it is kind of like folding origami, all the steps, multiple pins required sometimes. It can can be a lot. I know I personally don't have time for all of that. I only ever do it during our holidays, the two Eids, if I have time, because usually it's like a rushing to the prayer. But going back to sharing my screen with you guys. Okay. I hope you guys can also see my screen. Yeah, good. So we got down the job tutorial. Methods of pinning. So as you noticed, she had different pins there. Some common pins that are used, sewing pins. Actually did not know there were sewing pins because I don't sew. But I always thought of them as hijab pins. Like when I saw this, I thought to myself, wow, I have one. Like I have hijab pins. So it's usually little kids don't use this. When I was a little kid, I didn't, just because sharp things, sharp objects, children, it doesn't go together. The safety pins as well. Those are usually what I used if I had a style that needed a pin as a kid. One thing, this is pretty new to me, then I've only seen in the last few years, magnetic hijab pins. So instead of having to wrangle something with a sharp point at the end, you can just take one piece and the magnets will just keep it in place there. With regards to ADLs, I think this would be perfect if you come across a patient that has a neuro issue, a musculoskeletal issue, something that would require not being around sharp objects that would be unsafe for them. Using a magnetic hijab pin would be very helpful. So all of this, all of that background to talk about, you know, what does this all mean in the background when it comes to Muslim women and you as an OT or OT student? And I really like this paragraph, so I'm just going to read the highlighted part where she says, "It might sound alien to some, especially as some Muslim women are okay with hugs and handshakes, but it's something many Muslims quietly abide by. Going back to this idea of hijab, when you see a Muslim woman who is physically wearing the hijab, know that most often, 9 out of 10 times, there is that prerequisite that she's also is abiding to a code of modesty, the hijab that's not an actual garment. And so one thing with that is making sure that you, if you're a person of the opposite gender, that she may not want to hug you or shake your hand. For me, I remember from my high school graduation, and I wanted to share this story here. It was, so my high school graduation, and my last name is Abdi, so AB, I was the first one to go get my degree, my diploma. And I was walking up the stairs. I had chosen a female teacher to give me my diploma. But unfortunately, due to some logistical issues, like she wasn't on stage. And so the principal, who's a male, he like shook out his hand and he stood up and was like, congratulations, and tried to give me my degree. And for a half a second, I was like, because I didn't want to shake his hand, but I also didn't want to embarrass him. So, and embarrass myself as well, because there's thousands of people here at this graduation. So I shake his hand, I get my diploma. As I'm walking off and looking at the crowd, I can see literally all 9 of my siblings, my family, and they all just have their mouths slightly open, like, I can't believe she did that. I can't believe she shook his hand. When I got home, my mom, Hoy, was like, why did you shake his hand? I almost screamed. Why did you do it in front of the entire audience? Because it's something that she knew that at that moment, it was very uncomfortable for me as a woman that observes the hijab, that wears not only the garment, but also tries to observe a code of modesty, to shake his hand. And so while that wasn't known to much of the audience or even the principal who shook my hand, it was still something that like, even those who knew me were just kind of like, oh, I can't believe she shook his hand. He's a man. And so with that, you want to be like Justin Trudeau. Love him. You see in this interaction, he has his hand in his heart. He doesn't extend his hand or want to shake or want to hug. Let me put you guys onto some etiquette. This is a great way, COVID life. We're not allowed to, you know, touch anyone. We're 6 feet apart. Hand on heart, just like this, little nod. Nice to meet you. My name is Ifrah. How are you today? Little things like that. I know I do this now more often, even with people who are not of the opposite gender, because we don't have that physical interaction. And so I think everybody should do this. It's been nice. Yes, that's what I have for you guys today. There were a few things, because this was focused specifically on Muslim women. I didn't talk about being a Muslim just in general. So one thing, I saw this the other day on Twitter. It was like a viral news story. I couldn't find it anymore. But it was talking about the prayer, Salah. And there was a nurse who, there's a Muslim man. He was in a psychiatric hospital. He was there. And she saw him, you know, facing a certain direction. And it looked like he was muttering to himself. And so as a part of her neurological assessment, you would think like the first thing, I see a person muttering to themselves, looking at a corner, I should ask them, like, what are you doing? That didn't happen. So she just assumed something and didn't ask. And I don't remember the exact outcome of this, but it was negative on the part of the Muslim patient. And so while there was a lot of pushback and, you know, eyebrows raised, even for me, when I heard it, I was like, why didn't she just ask him, what were you doing? Because he was praying, he's focused, he's looking at a certain direction, he's not muttering, he's doing the prayer. So little things like that. I know, like I said, this is mostly focused on Muslim women, so, and the hijab, so that's what I did. But if you have any questions, let me know.
Thank you, Ifra. So last, we would like to introduce Dr. Elena James. Dr. James is a medical dermatologist and teledermatologist at the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center. Dr. James earned her undergraduate degree in molecular biophysics and biochemistry from Yale University. With a love for science, she earned her medical degree and PhD in cellular biology at Baylor College of Medicine as a student in the medical science training program. Dr. James completed her residency training at the University of Pennsylvania's Department of Dermatology with a concentration in skin of color. At UPMC Dermatology, Dr. James works closely with residents, medical students, and undergraduate students, and serves as Director of Skin Health Equity in Mobile Derm, a community partnership program to increase access to dermatologic care in local, rural, and global communities. As a clinician, educator, and researcher, Dr. James strives to improve dermatology and healthcare disparities and strengthen patient-provider relationships through community partnerships and service learning. These partnerships include underserved communities in Pittsburgh, rural Pennsylvania, Honduras, and Malawi. Thank you so much for taking the time to come and speak with us, Dr. James. And then we're also going to pause the recording. Is that correct?
Thank you. All right. So I am going to talking to your lecturers and making sure that it's represented in your classes and all of your learning. So thank you for listening. I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Thank you so much, Dr. James and Ifra and Moira. I know all of us have learned so much tonight. We have a lot of questions, and we're going to try to get through as many of them as possible. Please bear with us. If we don't get to your question in the time allotted, we apologize. Please feel free to DM them to our Instagram, and we will do our best to get an answer for you. So let's start with a question for Moira. Moira, how do you determine hair porosity? Excuse me. Is it more trial and error for what works for the individual?
It's Mariah, but yeah, and hair porosity. So I've been told that the test for hair porosity is to put a strand of hair into water and see, like, wait for like an hour or so and see if it sinks or if it floats. And that's supposed to tell you. Personally, from that experience, I did this test and my boyfriend also did this test. He has tighter curls, so 4C. And his hair, we know, is high porosity because certain products work well for him that don't really work that well for me. And I know that I'm low porosity. So the best way I could guess I could describe it is like wash your hair. And after you wash your hair, see about how long it takes to air dry. His hair takes a long time to air dry. Like it's, it take, Well, yeah, it takes him like a long time to get all the water fully out of his hair. And that's because his hair is like, the hair shaft has like, is open, but it's hard for the water to come back out, I guess. It's like a confusing question. I don't really know the answer. I guess I would Google it, because like my hair takes short to dry, but I know that my hair is low porosity. So.
Another question, we have one for Ifra. Ifra, are there different wrapping types for different purposes, or are they just for cosmetic and personal preference?
That one, the answer is short and sweet, just cosmetic. So there's no like specific head type or specific thing, unless you're from a different ethnicity or it's a very cultural. But religious, no. If it just fits that sub, if it fits the criteria, then it's hijab.
All right, Dr. James, did you learn about, quote, skin of color in medical school? I ask because I've had other healthcare worker friends who've discussed this as being a huge issue in education. If you aren't taught what to look for, how can you properly assess the issue?
Great question. So in medical school, not very frequently. I remember being very embarrassed by one of the presenters who was doing sexually transmitted infections in large images of, you know, genitals of skin of color. This was when the time where it was being present. We're currently working on an auditing system to look through medical school curriculums in a very systematic way to evaluate what lecturers are presenting and giving feedback to lecturers to help them and to give them resources to use in their lectures, because there has to be accountability and helping to figure out what is being presented, and if it's not being presented, helping them with resources. So it's a big project that we're working on. And I refer to it as visual learning equity.
Thank you. Another question we have for Mariah. For occupational therapists working in hospitals, what are your suggestions for being helpful or respectful for hair care for people of color while hospitalized and working on ADLs?
That's a really good question. I'm not sure how much access I guess you guys have to different things, but I think I got an email from one of you actually asking about some different products. And I feel like one thing is getting educated about the products, and that's as easy as a Google search or just looking at different natural hair girls who, like, you can literally search the hashtag natural hair on Instagram or YouTube just to get more aware of the different products that are meant for natural hair. And I guess another way that you guys could go about doing that is just having an open conversation, being open with the patient that you're with and saying, hey, like, what type of hair product do you use at home? Are there any products that you would rather not use or like rather avoid? Because I know specifically for me, when a few years ago I went through, I had like a skin condition that had something to do with the sun, and I had to use a special shampoo. It was like something like right here on my neck, but I had to use a special shampoo. And I specifically asked my physician, is there sulfates in the shampoo? And she said, no, I don't think so. I went to go pick it up and it was sulfates in it. So I guess just be mindful of like if your patients are asking questions, it's for a reason. Like, even though this product might help them, like, you just have to think about, I guess, those things and like the different things that if they're asking you specifically or verbalizing to you, you need to listen to them.
Ifra, what are some other activities of daily living that occupational therapists should ask about or be aware of with their Muslim clients? Would it ever be appropriate for an occupational therapist to assist you in donning your hijab, or is that considered inappropriate?
So my presentation mostly focused on the hijab, Muslim in particular, so not Muslims in general.
I did mention the prayer, so the salah, which is 5 times a day. So in the hospital, you may see patients who, my dad actually recently had COVID, so he's in the hospital. And so the entire time when we were like on the phone with the nurses, like, can you tell him the place of like the direction? Like, it needs to be this way. So they told him, and that was nice for them to do that for him. So this is the prayer. Eating, so there's dietary habits, so making sure there's no pork. One common thing, there's always a lot of memes about it, gelatin. Gelatin contains pork enzymes typically, or the gelatin in it. So just different things, making sure that the dietary laws are in place. And then what was the second part of the question? Sorry. Oh, we can't hear you.
It said, would it ever be appropriate for an occupational therapist to assist you in donning your hijab, or is that considered inappropriate?
It would be appropriate. Just make sure you're asking, but your mileage may vary in terms of, like I said, I know I personally would be fine with it. My mom would be fine with it. If they're in a situation where they can't put on their own hijab, go ahead and ask. And they would, of course, want you to do that for them because they believe in observing it.
Thank you, Yifra. One of the attendees kind of said, responding to Mariah, that at the hospital, there are typically only baby shampoo, a bar of soap, and a comb. Thank you for sharing that. For Dr. James, is all skin protection that is made for lighter skin also fit for skin of color? If not, what products would work best for sun protection for skin of color?
That's a great question. So for skin of color, the big problem is that the best sunscreens, zinc and titanium containing sunscreens, are pasty. And so there's this discoloration, an ashiness, a dryness that lingers, a residue. So it just doesn't look good. It doesn't look right, even though it's protective. So there are a lot of color matching sunscreens that can be beneficial, that have a color in them or iron oxide in them to help with the color. So color matching, they tend to be unfortunately more expensive than regular sunscreens. But our recommendation is for everyone to use zinc and titanium containing sunscreens as a physical block, but the color matching can help. The SPF number can be variable from 30 to 100 plus. And so we say if you're wearing 30 and you get a burn, then you need to bump it up. Sunscreen should be applied every 2 hours. The other big thing to be aware of with sunscreen is that we are blocking our body's natural way to produce vitamin D. And vitamin D is important in a lot of different processes in the body. So making sure we educate patients, especially skin of color, because less vitamin D is produced because of the protection from sun. So making sure vitamin D supplementation is given appropriately through diet, through vitamins.
Thank you. Mariah, I work in a hospital with patients who usually can't shower, especially in like the intensive care unit. Any advice to help patients with natural / textured hair keep their hair healthy while they are bedbound or can't wash their hair normally?
That's also a good question. I guess it would depend on the patient. And again, like having an open conversation with that patient to see like what I guess they're comfortable with. As well as what you're comfortable with as a physician. Because I know like hair takes time, like any type of thing, and hair takes time and patience and it takes care, like you need to care for it and stuff. So I guess if they can't do it themselves, maybe like offer it if you could help. I don't know if that's something you guys can do, but that would definitely be something that would be helpful. Like if you guys offered to help or offered to kind of like do whatever hair routines that they go through normally.
Thank you. Ifra, if you are unable to put on your hijab by yourself, who is allowed to assist you? And at what age do individuals start wearing a hijab?
I'm so sorry. Can you repeat that question? I was typing in the chat.
Of course. If you are unable to put on your hijab by yourself, who was allowed to assist you? And at what age do individuals start wearing a hijab?
Who is allowed to assist you? Those who you ask. So if I was bedbound, I'd ask my mom, my four sisters. Typically, I would ask a female. My brothers don't know how to wrap up hijab, so I wouldn't ask any of them, nor does my dad. So anyone that you ask. So if they ask you, go ahead. What age, the age that hijab should be worn is upon puberty, which usually is like 9 to 12, that usually happens. Some people, one thing that's very common actually that's happening across social media, it's new to me, like I didn't.
I think we lost her there.
A little bit.
So I'm gonna keep going and we can head back when she pops back in. So Dr. James, okay. Are you back? Did I lose you? Did you come back, Ifra?
You can finish your thought.
Sorry, we lost you there for a second.
Oh, okay. What was the last thing I said?
You're gonna talk about something that happened.
Oh, what was unexpected to me? So there's this concept of the hijab journey. Did everybody hear me say that? Hijab journey?
No.
No, okay. So this is new, and it's new to me. I've covered my entire life, so my hijab journey started when I was like two or one even. Like I've worn it my entire life. But for many women, especially in the modern day, where it's kind of hard to cover because there's a lot of stigma, people look down on you, it's different, just so many different things. So they'll gain the confidence to wear their hijab, and so they'll like cover their hair, look like a turban or something, which some people consider hijab. I personally don't consider the turban a hijab, but it's a different thing. And they'll fully cover. And so I think that's really cool. But to answer the question succinctly, at puberty.
Thank you for coming back and answering. Dr. James, I work with hands. Does dark skin scar differently? I work a lot on scar massage and management, and it would be helpful to know if scar resolution could take longer because of certain characteristics in the skin.
So yes, the melanin in the skin can go from the top layer of the skin into the second layer of the skin. And that dropping down into the dermis can sometimes induce more inflammation. There can also be more fibrosis that forms from trauma in darker skin patients or patients where, you know, hairs are getting coiled and ingrown. You can have scarring from that. We see that not only in darker skin patients, but patients who have red hair and have very thick and coiled hair that can have scarring as well. And so if I think that it's interesting, the massaging of scar tissue, there has to be a balance because we know that repetitive rubbing or friction to a scar that's thickened can cause it to thicken more. And so we're very careful patients who have thick scars to tell them not to rub or to scratch it because it can make it thicker over time. So being really careful that getting a history, if someone had, you know, ear piercings and they formed keloids, to know that because there's a higher likelihood of scarring in surgical sites or where there's pressure. And so that's important as well.
Thank you. So at this time, I'd just like to ask a question for all three panelists. And this question is going to be for all three of you. First one is, what are some positive experiences you have had with culturally educated medical personnel? And what are some characteristics of a positive experience? And how can we apply those characteristics to our own practice in the future? And let me know if I even need me to repeat those.
That's a hard question. I guess one positive experience that I had was, well, I mean, really any positive medical experience that I've had is somebody who's like empathetic towards me and who's nice to me and who treats me like how I want to be treated. Like, you treat others how you want to be treated. So that's, I don't have like a specific one, I guess, because yeah, I never really ran into that, I don't think.
I guess I can go next. I had an amazing experience with a nurse practitioner about 2 weeks ago. If everybody can hear me. Yeah, good. Yes, okay. With a nurse practitioner about 2 weeks ago, I went to go get my annual flu shot and I was not wearing the correct abaya to expose the top of my arm to get that shot. And so I would have to like completely strip and like take it off in order to expose that area. And the nurse practitioner, he was male, he made me feel very comfortable. One thing that he did that I really respect is that I told him, I literally just said, oh, I didn't think I'm wearing the right clothes today. He said, well, you can go ahead and expose that area for me, just that area. He turned around, I took off my abaya and then covered so that only my arm was showing. And then he gave me the shot and I really, really appreciated that. One thing that I think that clinicians should have, me as a future nurse and all of you as healthcare professionals, is just be curious, but do it in a nice way. Like, there are some questions that I think are, one question that I hope you never ask a Muslim woman is, do you shower with that hijab on? We've addressed it here. No, you don't shower with your hijab on. But it never hurts to ask a question. I don't think anyone will ever, you know, make you feel dumb or stupid when it comes to you when it comes to the hijab or to them as a person. So
yes, I agree with the other speakers, to be culturally curious and to be open and transparent. And so, you know, my daughter was talking to me about, she's in a predominantly white school, and so there is a little bit of a burden placed on her to explain things, which is, you know, unfortunate, but in explaining things that makes the barriers and the distance smaller and shorter, and so that there's an understanding. So it's very bi-directional that we have to be open and transparent about, you know, what we're doing and explaining it. And asking open-ended questions, not just yes, no, and never really assuming, because, you know, as a Black woman, I have certain habits and things that I prefer to do, but that doesn't represent all Black women. That just represents who I am. So really, really seeing people, I think my big point, as an individual. There are themes that we see, cultural themes, but everybody is an individual. And when you go into an encounter and an interaction and engaging, just listening, I've learned so many things from patients over the years that have benefited me in so many different ways, that I feel so blessed to be in a position where I can engage. And I really see healthcare as a partnership. You know, I am not doing all of the work and all of the things. We're going in with an agreement that our goal is to get the patient as healthy as possible and discussing it, talking with them, seeing what their needs and their wants are, and meeting them halfway, I think is really, really important and beneficial.
Okay. So this is going to be our last question of the night. If we're going to do our best, I know we have a lot more questions that we didn't have time to get to. We're going to do our best to get those answered and get those out to all of you as soon and as best as we can. But our last and final question is, in knowing all of the information that you've presented to us today for all three of you, how can we advocate for our clients or people in general and apply all of this information to our practice going forward?
I guess, like I said earlier, just make sure that you're listening to your patients. I know or I've seen statistics and I've seen different things about, for example, Black women who are pregnant and they have like altercations, or they say this hurts or that hurts, or something doesn't feel right. And my mom is an example with my youngest brother. Like if your patient says something, it's your right to listen, not to just be like, oh no, it's no big deal. I feel like listening and being an active listener and actually hearing what they have to say is something that's really important. And that's something you could take into any cultural setting, any setting, to see how somebody does something or wants to do something. You guys should be listening and trying your best. Obviously, you can't always do everything that they need, but trying your best to do whatever they need to be comfortable.
I'm still contemplating my answer on that one, but I would say just if you're equipped with this knowledge, making sure that your workplace, when you're dealing with patients, you're able to keep that in the back of your head. So you see a Muslim patient, you know that, you know, typically they pray 5 times a day. Do you know maybe the direction where it is to point it out for them? If they're wearing a hijab, is there, you know, maybe that there's a pin before you pull it off? Oh, are there any pins that I could help you take off? Just having that knowledge will go a long way in making sure that your care is seamless, and that you're treating them with that, you know, so that they know that you have been, that they, so that they know that you know, you know. If that makes sense.
I have two answers. I was trying to figure out a way to put it together into two. The first thing is based on my talk, and then the second is just general. I think it's really important as providers to understand that racism is real and it is pervasive in every aspect of our lives, not just individually from person to person, not just institutionally, but it is the fabric of our society. And that is hard to swallow and hard to understand. But when you're seeing themes, when you're seeing patients that may be coming from a certain neighborhood with chronic issues or chronic conditions, it's not just because they're Black, right? You have to understand that, because a lot of that is the sum total of what we're saying and what we're assessing of patients. We have to understand that, yes, they are Black in America and the way that they are treated, okay? So it's in the environment, in neighborhoods, it's in housing, okay? It's in politics, it's in education, it's in access to technology. So every aspect of somebody's life can be dictated on simply having brown and Black skin. That is one theme that I really want you to understand and take that into consideration when your patient may be struggling with multiple things that's happening in their life. It's not just their ADLs, it's everything else that's going on in their life. So trying to take that into consideration. And the second big theme is that as providers, you know, we work so hard to get to a certain level, right? You're struggling, you're studying, you're multitasking, you're trying to take care of yourself. And then there becomes this power dynamic, like I've done all of this to get to this position. But we have to really understand that our profession is of service, that we have to be humble, we have to be caring, we have to be patient. And I know a lot of the work that you all do is really in like daily, very intimate things that people have to take care of themselves, which are so important and oftentimes overlooked. So really taking, you know, the precious time to be, you know, such a servant, to be, you know, humble and caring to our patients who are so vulnerable when they come to us so sick and unable to do the things that they want to do or need to do, just really remembering that.
Okay, wow, thank you all so much for attending our event. We did not expect our event to attract this many people from across so many states and other countries. We would like to sincerely thank all of our speakers, Mariah, Ifra, and Dr. James, for joining us tonight and sharing their experiences and knowledge with us to help make everyone a more informed educator, practitioner, or future practitioner in the healthcare field. So we sent out a post-survey link in the chat, and we will also send it to the same email you used to register for this event. And we hope you will take the time to complete it. With the information we gained from this survey, we plan to submit a proposal to our state Occupational Therapy Association in hopes of making the topic culturally inclusive ADLs a standard in OT education. And the link to our survey can also be found on our Pitt OT website page and Linktree for those who may be viewing the recording of our event at a later date. So thank you all and have a good night.